Hey there, everybody. My name's Alex Parker. I'm a full-time freelance animator and designer based in Texas, working under my freelance brand, Ladybird Animation. I'm so excited to be here. Thank you so much to Maxon for having me. And to kick things off, I'm gonna go ahead and roll my reel. So sit back, relax, enjoy, get your snacks, and I'll catch you on the other side. There it is. That's my reel. That's my work. I hope you enjoyed it because I genuinely enjoyed making it. And so before we hop into the presentation, I wanted to go ahead and give a little bit of background info about myself. Again, my name is Alex Parker. I'm a full-time freelance animator and designer based in Texas. But before I was a freelance anything, I was a student at both Texas A&M University for undergrad and Bournemouth University for postgrad. And both of these were generalist-based animation curriculums, and they both focused on character animation for film along with the rest of the 3D pipeline. But it's also worth noting that these were both taught exclusively in Maya. So all of my academic background was for character animation for film in Maya. And it was toward the end of my time at Bournemouth University working on my master's thesis film that I was producing work that looked a little bit like this. Working on independent animated shorts, doing all of my own pre-production, so my own storyboarding, character design, concept art, color palettes, all that good stuff. And then that resulted in my short film that looked a little bit like this. This short was called Hand Wash, Line Dry, and I had an absolute blast working on it. And this short really affirmed for me that I did really want to be working on these really fun, stylized, bright, colorful, bite-sized animated shorts. Once I finished this short, it actually helped me land my first big girl job at a post house in Dallas called Infinite Fiction. And so here at Infinite Fiction, I was a generalist, I was a motion designer, and this is where the term motion design kind of entered my vocabulary. I had never heard of motion design before working here. I didn't know what it was. Come to find out, it's this awesome blend of both graphic design and animation. So perfect fit. Loved it. And it was actually at Infinite Fiction that I started working in cinema 4D. I had never used cinema before, but I really got into it here and absolutely fell in love with it. And so here at Infinite Fiction, everybody was a generalist who tended to have kind of a superhero skill in their back pocket. And so in this particular case, anytime we had a character piece come in, I would be the character lead and I would work on that aspect of the project, which I really enjoyed. And so at any given time, we were either working on like 2D supers that laid on top of commercials, or maybe doing entire 3D spots, like this Samsung one up here. I played the resident graphic designer sometimes. And then down here is the project that was really like the golden goose of all the projects that we got to work on here. This was a big title sequence for an AICP award show. Absolutely loved working on this project. It was a huge combined effort of everybody at Infinite Fiction. And this project had something like 30 shots in it, and this bird was in like 28 of them. So it was a huge character animation piece, but I absolutely loved it. It was such a dream, and it was pink, so had a blast. And it was this project that actually allowed me to check one of my major bucket list items off my list, which was taking a selfie in front of one of these really fun logo walls. So I had such a blast here, really loved the team, was so lucky to learn here. And then I ended up having to move. I had to move to Bryan, Texas. And so it was with that move that after about a year and a half, I had to make the jump from full-time employment at Infinite Fiction to full-time freelance. And so at that point, I founded my full-time freelance brand, Ladybird Animation. She's almost a year old now, so we're super proud of her. This is a selfie of me bringing home some sort of stamped piece of paper from the state of Texas that says that I'm allowed to freelance. So really, really excited to be where I'm at with Ladybird. And within the past year, I've been absolutely blessed to work with a host of really, really fabulous and fun clients. Some of these have been direct to clients, some of them have been studios, agencies, and some of these I've played the role of a graphic designer, animator, art director, motion designer, whatever it's been a blast, and I've really loved it and have been so fortunate for this to have gone so well and to have such a blast doing it. And so I'm really thankful for Maxon for having me back. I'm so glad to be here. And without further ado, let's go ahead and start what we're all here to talk about, which is the presentation, character animation, storybook style, and cinema 4D with me. So excited to have you all here. Storybook style animation is absolutely what I love doing. I'm so excited to be talking about it. And over the course of this presentation, we're basically gonna break down two projects. So we're gonna go behind the scenes of both of these, where we're gonna look at how some of the 3D tool sets within Cinema 4D helped bring these projects to life, helped get them animated, moving and grooving. And then we're also gonna talk about some of the tricks that I like to use in post to really put the cherry on top, give them this really fun, glowy, magical storybook feel. So that's the plan, buckle up, because here we go. So I wanted to kick things off by introducing you all to Doris. This is Doris, the bird behind Ladybird Animation. She's in my brand's logo, she's my brand's mascot. And when I was making my website, I wanted to make a couple of pieces of animated media just to jazz up the site, make it a little more welcoming, a little more fun. And so I've made this loop right here where Doris is just kind of looking around, twinkling her little birdie toes. And then I've made this one here where she just kind of waves hello. And so what I want to do next is take a look at these scenes within Cinema 4D to take a look at how some of the tool sets within Cinema made bringing Doris to life a whole bunch of fun. So we've hopped into Cinema, and if we hit play, we can see that this is the same scene we were looking at earlier. But one of the things that I wanted to talk about first was how I decided to style Doris. So Doris is the mascot of my brand, right? And my brand's ideal client is honestly like preschool children's programming. I would love to work on like an animated preschool TV show. And so with that in mind, I wanted to style my brand's logo and mascot in a very similar way, in a way that would appeal to those audiences. So I wanted Doris to look like a child could have made this model like out of Play-Doh or like modeling clay. So I chose a clay shader that really emphasizes these like handmade lumps and bumps. And even the way that this model is assembled, it is very much assembled in a way that looks like a child could have put this together. So that was a big part of my decision-making process. And I also wanted Doris to look not only handmade, but to have some hand-drawn elements as well. So as you can see in this final render up here, she does have feathers, but they're not like X-Gen hair system feathers. They're just very simple hand-drawn little swoops. And so I wanted to take a quick look at how I put that together, because this is a trick that I like to use in a lot of my character animations. So if we look here, we can see that where her feathers are in 3D, all they are just three little simple planes. That's it. They're not fancy. There are three little squares. So if we look at the material that's associated with these little planes, the feather material right here, it is so simple. I feel like I'm really outing myself with how simple this is. But we open this up and we have this feather image here, which if I make larger, we can see is literally just like a hand-drawn little swoop drawn in Photoshop with a really rough painterly brush. There's a little bit of paint texture within the swoop, but it's super, super small. And I've just taken this simple little on a PNG and thrown it into both the base color of the surface along with the cutout opacity. And so with that being said, that is literally it. That is all it takes. That's a trick that I use a bunch to get hand-drawn bits into my 3D scenes and to help them, you know, keep in line with my 3D stuff, to make them feel like they're part of the same environment, as opposed to maybe doing something like that in post, which you can certainly do, and I do all the time. But when it's attached to a character, this is how I like to handle that. And so I've just taken those simple little feather planes, and these are constraint tags, where I have just parent constrained them to the nearest spine controller. You could certainly use a clamp constraint if you're looking to clamp something to a surface. I find that those can be a little bit buggy sometimes, but they're certainly useful. In this case, Doris was not gonna be deforming a bunch, moving around a bunch. So just having these feather planes constrained to the nearest spine control absolutely did the trick. So that's how I set these up. And one of the other tricks that I wanted to talk about that I've used in this scene and a whole bunch of other scenes is how I handle animating any type of joint chain. So that'll be like fingers, toes, even a spine chain. Anytime I'm trying to animate a curve or a bend in a spine chain, I usually want to have these really like cartoony, evenly distributed curves. And so what I'll do is I'll set up a quick shortcut that allows me to select every joint in the chain and rotate them simultaneously instead of going one joint at a time. And so the way that I do that is what we'll do is we will just grab one of, we'll start with the spine actually. That'll give us a much bigger, easily visible example. And what I'm gonna do is go to my window customization and customize commands. And I'm gonna go select children. And let me tell you, I have gone back and forth between both of these options in this menu and not seen a huge difference in the way that they operate. I'm sure someone knows the difference. I would love it if they could tell me the difference, but I've not seen a difference in the execution of these two commands when I've tested them. And so I've grabbed this one, select children, and I've made the shortcut C, and I've restricted it to the object manager, because if you're a regular Cinema user, you know that hitting C in your main workspace is gonna make whatever object you're working on editable. And so to me, C stands for like children or chain, like a joint chain, and I've restricted it to the object manager so that when I hit C in here, I'm gonna select, let's see, what is this base joint here? My base spine, and then when I hit C, you can see that it selects the entire joint chain above this joint, below in the object manager, above, because these joints are oriented upward in the rig. But what that lets me do is rotate these simultaneously and gives me really round, evenly distributed curves, which I'm a huge fan of when I'm animating. And one thing you're gonna wanna make sure you have enabled when you're doing this is underneath your rotation tool, within those rotate settings, you're gonna want per object manipulation to be selected. Because you can see here, if we unselect that, it like, that's not cute. That's disgusting. So I'm gonna undo and make sure I have this selected. And what that does is it distributes your rotation values to each joint, which gives you these nice, round, evenly distributed rotation curves in your shapes. And I use this a lot when I'm animating, like I said, like fingers and toes. And that's how a lot of these toes down here are animated as well. If we go down, which they're really like, they're really tucked in here. These are kind of hard to access, but I'll grab one of these toes. I'll hit C to grab the whole chain. And you can see that it gives me really even access over the entire joint chain and makes animating things like a cute little birdie, like twiddling her toes, really easy and really fast. So it's a very streamlined part of my character animation process within Cinema 4D. So now that we've covered some of the 3D tips and tricks behind this animation, I wanted to talk about the compositing phase really quick. That's where I tend to get that really glowy storybook look that I'm usually looking for in a character piece. And so one of the things that I'll make sure to do in almost every 3D file is set up a really strong backlight to help me get that effect. And so you can see here in this file, we've got this ginormous backlight, and whether you call it a backlight, a rim light, a hair light, doesn't matter to me. I make them ginormous. I'm not shy. This one's set to like 50. The exposure's super high. This is a ginormous light. But what that helps me get is an integration between what's going to be my environment in post and getting that light effect to wrap around my character. And so this helps us get a little bit of that rim light here. And I'm going to pull up our compositing file. And you can see that this is the final result here. And we do get a lot of glow. But where a lot of that's actually coming from is this light wrap effect right here. So if we turn that off, we can see that this is what we're getting from Cinema, and I'll actually just solo our render. Here's our render by itself, not too shabby. And if we kick this white out of here, you can see that we are getting some help from that ginormous rim light in the back of the file, right? So it is helping us, and it is certainly helping blend that sky with the character, but I like to get dramatic with these light wraps. So this is a trick that I use in every single project of mine. There are definitely plugins out there for a more streamlined light wrap setup, but because this is something I use so often, I really appreciate that this is a plugin free setup. So I'm gonna walk through how I set this up in every single one of my files really fast. So I'll turn this off. I'm gonna make a new solid, and I'm gonna grab the sky behind us, because that's the color that I want the light wrap to use to wrap around Doris. So I've eyedropped the sky back here. I'll say okay, and I'm gonna name this light wrap demo. And then the first thing I'm gonna grab is a set mat. And it is worth noting, when we soloed that layer that came straight out of Cinema, you could see that we did have alpha information in that layer, which is crucial to get a light wrap to work, right? So I'm gonna tell my set mat to point at my render straight from Cinema. And then what I'm also gonna grab is a channel blur. And that's gonna help me control the softness of this light wrap effect. So I'll drop that in there. And then if I solo this, you can see that we're starting to get somewhere. And I'm gonna grab one more set mat to lock this in. Grab this, make sure the first one's inverted, the second one isn't. And then we'll tell the second one to also point at our doors layer. So if we, I'm gonna go ahead and also grab one more solid, like a really dark one, to help take a look at what we're making here. So I'm gonna grab just a black solid. All right, check it under here. And we can see it's super, super thin because we haven't blurred it yet. But if we knock this channel blur up, there we go. That's what I'm looking for. And so usually I'll layer a couple of these on top of each other. Sometimes I'll do a really, really wide, soft one at a super low opacity. And then I'll layer one on top that's a lot stronger, but it's much like narrower like this. So that's generally what I'll do. And you can see here that if I unsolo this, I delete this black solid that we've set up, you can see here that this light wrap just lays right on top of our render and really helps to bring it together with our glowy sky behind us and give us that really fun, gentle, storybook looking render that I'm usually going for. So the last trick I want to talk about with this project is this posterized time layer. So if you take a look at this, I've set up just a plain adjustment layer with the posterized time effect tucked in here. And if we open that up, we see that it's adjusting the frame rate of my project to 12 frames a second. And so if we go ahead, I've currently turned it off, so I'm gonna scrub through what this project would have looked like without posterized time. Pretty smooth, nothing to see here. And then we're gonna turn it back on and let this buffer out. And we can see that it's a much chunkier feel. It's dropped the frame rate in half. This was animated at 24 frames a second. Posterized time brought it down to 12. And so the motivation for that being when we talked about the design for this piece, right? I wanted it to feel very child-friendly, like a child could have made this model. And it's kind of meant to evoke those feelings of stop-motion animation, where your frame sequence is essentially just a series of photos taken one after another, typically at a much lower frame rate. And so this was a style choice that posterized time helps me get to much quicker. I enjoy animating at 24 frames a second. That's where I feel comfortable. And so there are some cases, you know, where posterized time isn't gonna be your best bet. And those are cases where you've got animation that's got very discrete points of contact or actual beats that you need to be hitting. And so examples of that might be a bouncing ball where you're gonna need to make sure you're capturing that frame of a ball hitting the floor, or two characters high-fiving each other. You're gonna wanna make sure you see all these contact points. Where in this case, if you were to animate those sequences at 24 frames a second, drop them in here, pop a posterized time on top, you don't have a ton of control over which frames your posterized time effect is going to get rid of. And so if it happens to get rid of those main beat frames or contact frames, your animation won't read as clearly and it won't be as successful. So in some cases, it's my saving grace in this particular instance where this is a very ambient animation. I didn't have any major contact points, any beats I needed to hit. It worked perfectly. In another case, if I did have those concrete beats I needed to be hitting, I might go ahead, change my approach, and go ahead and animate at my end desired frame rate within Cinema. In this case, it worked completely fine, and I knew that going in, so I knew that this was a fix that I could absolutely make in post and animate the way that I would prefer to in 24 frames a second back in Cinema. So moving right along, for the next part of this presentation, we're gonna take a look at another one of my personal projects. This one is actually still in progress. It is a series of short little animated vignettes about a Nordic fisherman named Oleg, who, as we might guess, is just not very good at being a fisherman. So what we're gonna do is take a look behind the scenes at the character design process, some of the steps that I go through when I'm getting a character designed and ready from the ground up for stylized animation. And then we'll take a look in Cinema 4D at some of the steps that I go through to get the character rig ready for some really fun stylized animation as well. So when I'm working on a character piece, I tend to follow the same process every time. So I want to give you a look behind the scenes at some of the decisions that I tend to make as I'm designing a character, getting him ready for some fun stylized character animation. So my first stop with any project is always, always color. I personally like to work within a pretty restricted color palette, and I also tend to favor the split complementary approach to color design. And so what I'll do is I'll pick two tones, one on either side of the color wheel, and then I'll kind of fill that palette out with some adjacent tones on either side to kind of give that palette a little bit more depth and a bit more dimension. And so in this particular case, I let Oleg's environment inform a lot of the color decisions we made here. He's a fisherman, he's spending plenty of time out at sea, so blue seemed like a pretty good place to start. And then to complement that blue, we're gonna want a much more orange-driven tone. So in that case, we ended up with this more coral, peachy tone to kind of reflect some of the coral we might see or some of the crab shells we might find out there. And then I filled out that palette with some sandy beiges and then some deeper, more navy-infused blues. And so once I got that palette ready to go, I needed to find my color proportions, meaning how much of each color does my character get. And the way that I like to make that choice is by identifying the high and low frequency tones in my environment and then inverting those for my character. In this case, his environment is the ocean, it's water. So it's gonna be blue is our high frequency tone, and then we're gonna see a lot less of that coral color. So what I wanna do is invert those for our character to make sure that he does have a little bit of that blue in his sweater and his hat, but his hero color is gonna be this bright, punchy coral. And what that does is keep him the center of attention in each frame, makes him easy to find. It also makes sure that he's still speaking the same color language, living in the same color space as his environment, keeping him related to everything around him, but making sure that he's got a bright, fun characteristic that makes him easily identifiable within frame. And so once I've got my color palette and my color proportions ready to go, what I like to do is define my character's hero shape. And so that is something that depends largely on the character's personality, who they are, what they like, what they do. And so what this is, I'm going to break down really, really fast some really basic kind of shape character psychology. And so if we think about the characters we all know and love, they probably all fit into maybe one of these shapes or a blend of these shapes. If we take a look at the characters we know that fit into this circle shape, we have our Mickey Mouses, our Winnie the Poohs, Kirby. These are characters that are, they're warm, they're bouncy, they're welcoming, right? They're happy characters. And if we take a look at this triangle, we're gonna see characters that are characterized by drama. They thrive on contrast, energy, right? If we take a look at the triangle itself, it's full of contrast. It's got this super, super narrow point to the top, contrasted against this really wide angular base. And so if we think about the characters that fit into this category, we're gonna see a lot of our villains. We're gonna see the really angular bone structure of like Maleficent and her super angular horns, right? Or we're gonna see maybe Jafar. His entire body is one long dramatic triangle. Or if we flip this upside down, we'll see a lot of our superheroes. We'll see maybe Mr. Incredible and his super, super broad shoulders contrasted against his much thinner waist, right? So these are characters that thrive on energy, contrast, and drama. And then if we take a look at the square, we're gonna see a much sturdier character, a much more stubborn character maybe, one that's bent on immovability, like maybe one that's a little more like Carl from Up, or maybe like Wreck-It Ralph or our Incredible Hulks, right? Really strong, stubborn in their opinion, immovable characters. And of course, there are plenty of characters that are a blend of these or maybe fall in between these categories, but these are the very generic starting points for defining your character's hero shape based on their personality. And so for my character, for Oleg, I actually went with a combination of both the triangle and the square, and I ended up with the wedge. I love the wedge, big fan of the wedge. I'll see it a lot in mid-century design as well. And so for here, we have to decide, is he a top-heavy wedge or is he a bottom-heavy wedge? And that goes back to what we just talked about with that triangle, right? If we have a top-heavy wedge, it's gonna give us subconscious expectations of maybe a much broader shoulder, a much stronger character, like maybe a Johnny Bravo, right? Our fisherman is not a Johnny Bravo. He's a fisherman who's super, super timid and bad at being a fisherman, right? So we'll find if we invert that shape, we also invert those expectations for our character. We suddenly don't expect him to be this big, brawny guy. We invert those expectations when we invert the shape. And so what I've done here is I've overlaid that shape on top of our character to give you a feel for just how pervasive this shape is in his shape design, right? We're finding it in his nose, front and center. We're finding it in his ears, even the insides of his ears. It's present in how narrow those shoulders are in contrast with his hips. And it's also present in how narrow these shoulders are contrasted with these big kind of clumsy, chunky sweater rolls. And so what I want to do now that we've identified our character's hero shape, is take a look at how the deformers within Cinema 4D helped us make sure that we were keeping that hero shape present in our character's design throughout the character modeling process. All right, so just for reference, this is Oleg's final 3D character model. You can see here that it matches the sketch we've laid out pretty well, but what I'm gonna show next is one of the earlier iterations of this model as I was just blocking out the model in 3D and how Cinema 4D's deformers helped me get from that initial blockout phase into a more tailored shape that better aligned with our concept art. So we're gonna say goodbye to this cute little final version of Oleg and head over to a much earlier blocky phase. So we'll go to this file here And this is what Oleg's body looked like for a very long time. Makes me very sad. But at this point, I was just trying to block out a basic humanoid shape, get my edge flow going in the right directions, and then I was gonna start tailoring it in to match the concept art. So from this early blocky phase, one of the things that really helped me out to stay on model was throwing in a reference of my sketch behind here in the frontal camera. And so setting this up is super simple. You'll just head to one of your orthographic cameras and then hit Shift V, which will bring you to your viewport settings, go to the back tab, and then just hunt down the file that you're looking for, and it'll chuck it right back here for you. So I've got my sketch back here, and I laid Oleg's body model over it, and you can see that what I want are these like really skinny shoulders up here, this kind of wedge-shaped body, right? But the block out that I have right now is pretty rectangular. I'm not getting that same like soft wedge shape that I want. And so instead of adjusting these vertices edge loop by edge loop and going in by hand and trying to taper this shape by hand, what I was able to do instead is I'm gonna put this back, I'm gonna hop in here, and currently you can see that this is really just a half body chucked into a symmetry object, right? So what I'm gonna do is go ahead and just collapse this down into one piece. Ordinarily, I would definitely be saving iterations. I would take that object, throw it off to the side, then condense it, and then kind of work like that. So I tend to just keep kind of just like a collection of like X pieces all around a scene. But for now, we're gonna be brave. We're gonna go ahead and collapse this so we just have one piece of geometry to work with. And I'm gonna go up here and find me a taper deformer. And so I'm gonna grab this, tuck it underneath the body, and then ask it to pretty please fit to parent. So it's nice and snug up here, and we can see that the active end of this deformer is up here by the shoulders. So if I go in here to our front view, you can see that all it takes is just a little tug on this strength deformer, and already this blockout is much more on model. It's fitting our sketch much better, and we can even, since I want this curve where you can see his sweaters pulling out behind the sides here, there's a parameter for that. I can adjust this here, and suddenly that taper is a much softer, rounder taper. And suddenly this really rough blockout that I was able to knock out pretty quickly went from being a rough blockout to something that was much more on model. And using these deformers in Cinema 4D, I love because they're a very parametric approach. If I don't like something, I just Command Z, I rip the deformer off, I start over. None of this is a destructive workflow, which I really appreciate. So with that in mind, this is a pretty quick fix. I want to take a look at Oleg's hands because those took two deformers actually to knock into shape. So I'm going to head up here to my hand progression file where you can see all the steps that it took getting Oleg's hands into shape. So I started out very similarly to the way that I did with the body, just a very basic block out, right? All I want at this point is a hand with fingers. I'm not making major design decisions at this point. I'm just blocking this out. And so you can see here, we're adding each model a little bit more detail, adding a thumb, extruding, adding a little bit more fidelity to the models as we go along. And this is also just how I model in general. If I'm working on a character piece, a heavy modeling piece, whatever, I will make a little bit of progress and then I'll duplicate that, shove it off to the side and keep working so that just in case I make a bad edge loop, I delete something on accident, I've always got a version to go back to. So I end up with kind of like a graveyard of all these character pieces. But it always gives me an easy out if I need to go back to a previous version. And so while this is by no means a modeling tutorial, what I do want to talk about here is how we get to this wrist part. So you can see here that in this hand, I've got a ton of edge loops because I'm gonna need a ton of information in the tips of these fingers, right? I'm gonna want fingernails. I want these fingers to be able to articulate really well. So I need a lot of information edge loop wise up here in the hand, and I don't need it in the wrist. So what I've done here is I've cleared out all these edge loops in this hand right here, and it's actually in the next step that I've kind of remedied that. And so you can see here, and I'm gonna put a chart right up here that shows a few edge loop reduction techniques that can help you go from X number of edge loops to much less number of edge loops, which is really helpful when you're going from areas of high deformation to low deformation, such as in this wrist here. I'm gonna need more edge loops at this section here so I can bend the wrist nicely, but I don't need any more information down here in the arm. That's just not necessary. So while it's not totally ideal to have edge loops kind of dead ending into each other like this, it does help reduce the number of edge loops here that would have caused me trouble when it came time to rig and to weight paint. It's no fun to weight paint with information that you don't need. So that's the little trick I used here. These charts I find to be incredibly helpful, and they're all over the internet. Here's one. Super, super helpful. So anyway, we're moving right along. We're adding fingernails at this point. But as we can see here, while it's nice that the fingers have this fun wedge shape, the entire hand itself is still pretty blocky. That's not the hero shape that I set out for my character. And while it is nice to keep things blocky like this, because it helps, at least for me, it helps me keep a really nice even edge flow, this is not the overall shape that I want. I want to get to something more like this. And you can see that we got here through a taper deformer. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna actually grab this hand right here because it does have all the fingernails ready to go. I'm gonna grab this and I'm gonna pop it into a new file all by itself. And then I'm going to kindly ask it to come to center stage. Here we go. So here's our hand and I'm just gonna clear these deformers out and we're gonna start from scratch. So this is our hand. I'm gonna give us a shading style that's maybe a little nicer to look at. And then we're gonna chuck this into a deformer just like before. I'm gonna grab a taper, throw it underneath, ask it to please fit to parent, and then we'll see which end the active end is on. Okay, and that's not the end that we want, but easy fix. I'm gonna rotate it here 90 degrees, and then I'm just gonna adjust this by hand to make sure that this deformer is generous enough to cover the entire model so that we get a nice fall off. So if you look at this, already we can see that from here to here, this is much more of a wedge than we were getting before with that really blocky hand model, right? This is much more on model and on hero shape with our original sketch. But something else that I wanted to talk about was just the overall form of this hand. It's not super organic yet. It's like kind of like a big paddle. And what I wanted with this hand model was for it to have kind of a more organic bend, kind of like along this axis, you know, just letting the hand fold like this, instead of being a really flat, almost just stiff CG looking paddle hand. And so I did that with a bend deformer. So instead of going through, grabbing a chunk of vertices, rotating them around, grabbing this finger's worth of vertices and rotating them, that wasn't gonna give me a clean result, but what would give me a clean result is a bend deformer. So I'm gonna drop this under here too. We're gonna try to fit it to parent, but as we'll see, it's probably not gonna do what we want right off the bat. Yeah, that's just like not ideal. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna exaggerate this just so we can keep track of which way it's bending in, and then I'm gonna just rotate it into place by hand. So I'm gonna go over here, and this is just gonna give us some really crazy stuff while we try to land on the axis we're looking for. But it's all reversible, so nobody panic. It's all parametric. But let's see here. We're starting to get it on the axis that we're looking for, right? This is starting to look a little bit more like what I'm wanting. And so what I want is for this bend deformer to encapsulate the entire hand. So let's see here. This is getting closer to what I want. Closer, closer. Okay, so we're getting somewhere. We're still getting a little bit of stretch along these fingers here, but since the bend deformer is encapsulating the entire hand, we can see that we're much closer to this organic bend shape that we wanted. And if we go back to our original hand file, we can see that we did achieve that with this hand here. We can see that the entire hand is encapsulated and we're getting a nice even bend that makes it a very organic rounded shape that resulted in our final hand file right here, where we get a nice even bend. We didn't have to go vertex by vertex, adjusting all these bits by hand. It was a very evenly distributed curve and a very evenly distributed taper that resulted in a hand that's much more on model with our sketch than, you know, these original hand shapes back here. So using these deformers in the modeling process, I found to be extremely helpful in getting very gentle adjustments to my model that helped them stay more aligned with our character sketch. And there's one more use case for the deformer that I just wanted to point out. Here, we can see this is an early, excuse me, there we go. This is a very early version of Oleg's head, at which point we can see up here, I was still relying on the use of a live deformer to get this head into shape. We can see that before it's a little narrower, now it kind of bulges out on top. But what I wanted to show was just the sheer variety you can get with a taper deformer. So I'm gonna go ahead and flip this upside down so that we're dealing with his chin more so than the top of his head. and I just wanted to show the amount of variety you can get with one base model, especially when you're making these fun stylized characters. Throwing a deformer in here can really help you get some fun stylized shapes without having to do a ton of work by hand. So I flipped this deformer around and we can see here that just with the use of one parameter, we can get a ton of variety. Like, he's cute, little gumdrop head. And this is using the same base mesh. It would take very small tweaks to a UV map to be able to repaint and get a nice texture going on here. But I just wanted to show with this super quick little example just how much variety there is available with these taper deformers and with really all of the deformers in the Cinema 4D library. So that is the end of my deformer workflow, but I absolutely loved using these throughout my process. They're non-destructive, they're a fun way to work, they give you really fast visual feedback on your design process. So I absolutely loved using them in the character design process for this project. So looking at this character sketch again, we can see that one of the trademark characteristics of this design is this little jelly bean mouth that I really wanted Oleg to have. I wanted him to have this really cartoony, expressive face, and that included this little rubber band shaped mouth. And so if we look at this expression sheet here, we can see that this mouth is super elastic, really stretchy, and is able to hit a lot of these really stylized shapes. And so what we're gonna do next is take a look at how I set up a mouth like this in Cinema 4D, and we might even make it move a little bit. So let's hop into Cinema 4D and see how we set this up. All right, so we're back in Cinema 4D and we can see that we've got this mouth set up here, which looks basically just like a jelly bean being extruded into the face. And so I'm gonna hop into our object manager here and see what the bones of this look like. And as we open this up, we can see that it's basically just an extruded spline, which gives us our mouth shape, being booled out of the head shape. So we've got our main bool, we've got our head, and we've got the mouth, and the mouth is being subtracted from the head via this bool here. So it's basically just one boolean being held into the rig system by three simple constraints. We've got a parent constraint, a clamp constraint, and an aim constraint. And I'm gonna walk through each of those individually, but what I wanna do first is just grab this mouth shape, I'm gonna copy it, and I'm gonna throw it into a new project so we can just investigate it a little more. So I'm gonna delete these constraints, we don't need them in this file, and then I'm going to drag this to center stage. So we're looking here, I'm gonna turn this extrusion off for right now and just highlight the spline itself. So you can see here that this is the base of our mouth shape. All it is a simple Bezier curve, and if we go into vertex mode, we can see it's just made of four simple points, 1, 2, 3, 4, that are gonna be animated in point level animation mode, which is super important to note. When you are animating, you'll wanna have point level animation enabled, which is this button right here. With that being said, there are two points that I wanna make about this like super simple, stretchy, expressive little jelly bean mouth. One being, it needs to be a closed spline. Second being, that you wanna build this shape with the least number of vertices? Regardless, possible. Because once you're in point level animation mode, you're gonna have to interact with every point individually to keyframe your shape. So you wanna make sure that you're dealing with the least number of vertices possible. Now, if there is a case where you do need a mouth shape that needs more fidelity, it needs more vertex points to define the shape, that's totally fine. Hop into a new file, build out a new spline with more points on it, and then you can just use that extrusion, pop it into your rig file. It's a super modular setup. So you can swap things out on a per shot basis depending on how much detail you need. But that being said, it really is just a simple spline that we're animating with point level animation. And I do go into more detail on this particular method in a previous talk, which I'm sure we can link down here below. But we were talking about using this method in a Cinnamon Toast Crunch spot. So there's a previous talk that goes into much more detail there than we're gonna go into today. But at this point, we're gonna go ahead and move on to the extrusion. So I'm gonna go up here and I'm going to enable this extrusion again. And we'll see that it's just a super simple cap. Let me select this so I can orbit a little nicer. There we go. Okay. And if we go into our caps tab on our extrusion, we'll see that it's this round cap right here that's giving us kind of this faked mouth bag. And it all depends on the depth of this slider right here. Just wanna make sure we max out that roundness so that we can kind of fake this nice round mouth bag back here. So with that being said, that is the basis of our mouth shape. Super simple. You can see as we pull these points around, the mouth bag responds interactively. And what I'm gonna do next is I've set up this demo file. So I'm gonna go here, and all I've done is pop that mouth that we were just playing with into this rig setup. It's completely on its own. It hasn't been constrained. You can see here that if we move the neck around, the mouth isn't gonna follow. So we're starting essentially from scratch here. So there are a couple things that we want to have in place to make sure this mouth plays nicely with the rest of the rig. And so the first thing I'm gonna do is a parent constraint. So I'm gonna right click and I'm gonna go to rigging tags and constraint. I'm setting up a parent constraint because as we just saw, this mouth doesn't respond to the rotation of this joint right here, and we would like it to. So I've set up a parent constraint and I'm gonna go find the joint that I'm looking for, which is this one right here. So I'm gonna hunt it down in our hierarchy and we'll see that it's the control for the head. So we've got the parent constraint here. I'm gonna grab this target pointer and point it to the head. So now you can see that when we do move this controller around, that the mouth is doing its thing, it's following along, which is what we want it to do. Now our second objective is to get this mouth to stick to the surface of the face. When we're animating this, I want it to be able to slide all around the face. I want him to be able to go from a surprised face to a big smile that slides up the side of his cheeks. And that's the reason why I went for a setup like this as opposed to something that depends on a more rigid facial structure. But that being said, getting the mouth to stick to the surface of the face is gonna be really important in getting an easy animation process going. So I'm gonna go back to my mouth object and show you what I mean. If I move this around, there's currently nothing stopping me from pulling this mouth bag just like out into space. There's nothing stopping me from just pulling this in all three axes, making animation kind of a pain. So I'm gonna put this back and I'm gonna go grab me a clamp constraint. So I'm gonna right click on this, rigging tags, constraint. I'm gonna give this a clamp constraint, go into this tag here and I'm gonna tell it to stick to the surface. And then when it's asking me to define which surface, I'm gonna tell it to the subdivision surface of the face, this head right here. So we can see now, what I'm also gonna do is hop into this tab and crank the priority number up, which there's a whole bunch of witchcraft going into priorities, frame delays, all that kind of stuff. I am by no means a priorities wizard, but in general, clamp constraints tend to be a little buggy. So what I'll tend to do is crank that number up and then also make sure that my objects are in the right order in the object manager, because Cinema is gonna calculate from top to bottom. If my mouth right here is dependent on the location of the head, which it is, I don't want this mouth to be above the head in the object manager. It's gonna cause a delay and it's just not gonna, it's not the desired result, right? So that being said, that is the absolute tip of the iceberg on the dirty beast that is priorities. But that's the way I've set this up for now. And we can see here that when I slide this mouth around, we're getting a little bit of redrawing errors with the bool, but what it's doing is it's sticking to the surface of the mouth, right? I'm not doing anything with the depth axis. I'm only moving this one right here. And while the results are a little scary, it is sticking to the surface of the face, and that's what I want, because what that lets us do is animate in just two axes instead of three. We're not having to handle the depth of this mouth. The clamp constraint is handling that for us, which is super nice. It's always preferred to animate in two axes over three. So what we're gonna tackle next is the last part of the puzzle. If we take a look at this mouth, we'll see that if we do an extreme expression over here where the mouth's kind of on the side of the face, we're not getting a really even distribution of this clipping. We're kind of getting this glancing angle where the mouth bag is kind of just tangentially running through our face. We're not getting a nice, deep, convincing mouth bag because our mouth bag isn't orienting itself. Our spline isn't orienting itself toward what I would like it to be at the back of the spine. So I'm gonna undo this and I'm gonna set that up really quick. So if I'm gonna use an aim constraint, that constraint is gonna ask me, well, what do I aim towards? What do I point to? So we're gonna go ahead and tackle that really quick. We're gonna make a null and it's gonna chuck it way at the top of our hierarchy. And I'm gonna call it mouth aim. And I'm gonna drag it way down here back to this familiar part of the hierarchy, and I'm gonna tuck it right underneath the head. That's this joint right here we've been dealing with. And I'm gonna do that, and I'm gonna zero out this coordinate right here. So since we've done that, we know that it's in line with the spine, which is what I want, but having this aim down here, that's a little too low for me. I'd rather the mouth bag be orienting itself almost toward like the bottom of the nose. So I'm up here, this is in line with his spine. I'm pulling it up toward the bottom of the nose. And then just to be safe, I'm gonna go ahead and just freeze transformations. Why not? So now we're ready to set up our aim constraint since we've set up our aim object. So I'm gonna go back to my mouth. I'm gonna right click, go for my rigging tags, get one last constraint, and I'm gonna give this an aim constraint. It's gonna ask me, what do I aim to? And I'm gonna tell it the mouth aim. Now, granted, now that we've done that, it's a little wonky, but we're looking to get this x-axis of the mouth oriented back toward that aim that we've just set up. So I'm gonna go down here on axis and go for the x positive, and that snaps us right back into place. And so we can see here that now when my character's moving around, I can also move his mouth around and it's gonna stay oriented toward the back of that spine so that the mouth bag is always nice and deep. It's not hitting our character's face at a tangential angle, and it's doing that on its own. We're not having to go in and counter animate the angle of this mouth as we animate our character. Also, these eyes are extremely unnerving in this view. I apologize. But anyway, that's the kind of setup we're looking for, where this mouth can be super, super expressive. It's not bound to a certain region of the face. It has these super cartoony properties in which it can just slide all the way across the face, be as big or as small as we want. And then these constraints in cinema kind of take care of some of that dirty work for us. The orientation work, clamping it to the face, that's all stuff we no longer have to worry about because this constraint system in cinema has got that taken care of for us. So, real quick, I'm gonna hop into the IPR to show y'all what this looks like at render time. So we've got our mouth pulled up in the IPR. I am in an older version of cinema just because that's where my very stubborn Arnold license lives. But if we take a look at this, we can see that maybe as expected with a Boolean, we're getting some undesirable artifacts right along the edge of where that Boolean hits the mouth and that where that mouth hits the face. And so what we're gonna do is you've got one of two options. One, you could paint these artifacts out in post, which sometimes I've got the patience for, but not today. So what I'm gonna do instead is I'm gonna go to my Boolean object, and here what it's currently doing is asking to create a single object out of our new Boolean. If we uncheck this box, that'll relieve some of the pressure off of this Boolean, and what it's gonna do is clean up those edges for us. So as this IPR kind of sorts itself out, you can see we're no longer having those artifacts along the edge of the mouth, which is super nice. And what we can also see here, which this might be a little tough to see over broadcast, but really tight in on these edges, what we're seeing is that the subsurface scattering is still treating this as one whole object. So we are getting a very, very slight gradient right along the edge of this mouth that just kind of helps bind the mouth to the face, makes them feel like one complete part instead of maybe like a mouth shape that was slapped on in post, which I've certainly done as well, but I do like that this gradient kind of helps give us a more natural transition between the mouth and the face. So, with all that being said, that is my mouth setup for this project. I hope you enjoyed it. I really enjoyed setting it up. It solved a lot of really interesting problems for me, and I really enjoyed kind of piecing together different parts of Cinema's pipeline to get me a really unique solution to the design challenge that I had with this project. All right, so for the final stop in this presentation, we are back in After Effects and we are parked on a frame from my Oleg animation to give you a look at a few more of the tips and tricks that I like to use in post to make sure I'm getting these fun, whimsical, magical style renders. And so first stop is gonna be the light wrap. We love the light wrap. We talked about this in the Doris project, but if we take a look here with Doris, we were able to just take that light wrap and just chuck it on top, no further adjustments. In this case, if we toggle this on and off, we can see that what it's actually doing instead is kind of obstructing this white fishing line that we have going down the left third of our frame. And so what I'm gonna do there is a simple, simple fix. I'm gonna go over here to the mode column and I'm gonna just select a blend mode that's gonna respect those white pixels underneath. So I'm gonna go up here and grab something like screen. And there we go, we can see here that we can now easily identify this white fishing line coming down the left third of our screen, and it's also retained this nice glowy effect around our character here. So we'll toggle that on and off. Not much noticeable change to the glow around our character, and we are able to read that fishing line. So no blend mode is gonna stop me from using my light wrap. And so beyond there, the first step that I always like to use in my renders is gonna be a color adjustment. And granted, I'll usually make further adjustments after this one that I'm about to explain here, but this one is always my first stop. So we can see that I've got a color adjustment layer. It's totally cleared out, there's nothing in here. And what I'm gonna do is walk you through my first step. So I'll go up to effect, it's right here for me, but in general, it'll be under color correction and then color balance. So I'll pull that in, and my first step is always to yank the shadow red balance way up. I'm usually pretty aggressive with this number. And what this does for me is it lifts some of the black out of the shadows, right? I want my shadows to be nice and warm. I want to get this warm bounce light going around in my scene. If I'm not able to get enough of that in render, I'll address it here by upping the red in my shadow balance. And then I'll also go over here and I'll do the same for the highlight red balance. Now I'm a lot more conservative with this number here, but I'll find what this does is it helps address if I'm getting really like pure white highlights in my character's clothing and their skin tone. I wanna take some of that pure white and kind of warm that up a little bit. That's the whole goal with this first step in my color adjustment process. And I find what it also does is it accentuates the colors that I like to use in the subsurface scattering values of my character's skin shader. I like to use really bright, punchy, saturated like reds and fuchsias in their subsurface scattering values. And I find that addressing the shadows and the highlights helps accentuate those colors, gives the skin tone a lot of warmth to it, a lot of liveliness to it, while also keeping the mass general color of our color scheme on model, making sure that we're not shifting too far off the initial color palette for our character. So I'll of course make further adjustments beyond that, but this is a step that I tend to make with almost every render that I pull into After Effects. And so beyond that basic color adjustment, you can see again, we've got posterized time. I use it again, sorry. And beyond posterized time, you can see here that on the very, very tip top of my stack, I've got a grain and chromatic aberration layer. And so this is something that I like to do to all of my renders to give them kind of this old style charming feel. And this is by no means a novel approach. It's absolutely been done before. It's fairly common practice to give renders a more like physical film-based feel, right? Because if we think about older animations, right? At the like the dawning age of animation, they weren't digitally produced. They were not CG. They were hand-drawn cells that we were taking photographs of one after another. And so with those physical photographs, we were getting artifacts like the grain on the film and then the chromatic aberration of that lens of the camera, right? And so I like for my animations to kind of evoke that same charm and that same nostalgia of these older animations. And so to do that, I make sure and throw a grain and chromatic aberration onto each project. And so I'll put grain on top. I'm pretty conservative with these values. These are just kind of the factory values with this setting here. And then I'll also throw on a chromatic aberration. And I'm going to zoom in so that we can kind of see the effects of this here on the sides of his hands, right? And so granted, if I were trying to match footage, match grain, if this were a VFX project, this would be a much different process, right? We'd be much more meticulous with these values. In this case, this is a completely art direction driven process. I am making these decisions stylistically, right? And so when I want these fun, warm, glowy renders, again, I'm gonna prioritize red. I'm gonna make sure that the red value has the highest absolute value of all my aberrations, red, green, and blue. So I'm gonna prioritize red, yank it down the furthest. I tend to stay around negative 1.5, negative 2, and then I skip down to blue and I push that in the opposite direction, right? We're gonna have red on one side, blue on the other. We can see that here in the red, if I toggle this on and off, the red kind of pulling out of these fingers, right? Along with some of the blue that we're seeing like on the other side of this fishing pole, right? Or maybe coming off of this little sweater cuff. I do tend to skip green, which of course is not physically accurate, right? But when I want really warm, glowy renders, green does not tend to play a part in that process. Unless it's a specific tone in my color palette, I tend to avoid green and favor the more warm red tones. And so if we toggle this whole layer on and off right here, we can see that these final touches are super minor, but they just kind of give the render a final touch of a bit more charm, and they kind of evoke some of those more nostalgic feelings of early animation. And so that is the end of my compositing process, or at the very least, the end of my absolute first stop go-to steps in my compositing process for whimsical, magical looking animation. Well, that's all I've got. Thank you so much for sticking around. A brief recap of what we talked about. We talked about adding some hand-drawn bits to our 3D scenes to get some fun 2D illustration integrated into our animations. We also talked about setting up an easy joint chain rotation to get fun, smooth, bendy shapes in our characters. We also talked about making it glow in post, setting up nice glowy light wraps around our characters. We also talked about defining our character's color palette and their hero shape, and then using the deformers within Cinema 4D to whip our characters into shape. We talked about building out a nice custom cartoony mouth rig for our character, as well as my go-to color and treatment adjustments in post to get glowy storybook style renders. So I hope this presentation's been enjoyable. Hope it's been helpful. I certainly enjoyed making it. And with that, if there's anything else you need, you can find me at ladybirdanimation.co. It is indeed .co. It's not .com. You can also find me on all social platforms under Alex Parker Design. And so with that, that's all I've got. Thank you so much for Maxon for having me, and I'll chat with y'all soon. Bye, y'all.